welcome to the program. Thad Cochran won yesterday. A guy who is about 117,000 years old. They won by people like Orrin Hatch going and giving all of their campaign donations to Thad Cochran to reach out to black Democrats to make sure that Chris McDaniel didn't win. And Chris McDaniel lost by 1 point. He lost by 6,000 votes. And those were all purchased with the money given to him by people like Orrin Hatch and Mitch McConnell.
So yeah, Glenn,
congratulations on that.
Really interesting stat that's just coming out now. They're doing the analysis and breaking down the vote totals. It's pretty amazing. Just the increase of the voters in black Democrat districts, if you just that accounts for about 9 points. So Chris McDaniel, among actual Republicans, wins that election by 8. Instead, he loses by 1 because Thad Cochran and people like Orrin Hatch have decided to give money to go recruit Democratic voters who are not going to vote for Thad Cochran or any other Republican ever, but to manipulate what the Republican people wanted. The voters and the actual party actually wanted Chris McDaniel, and they went out of their way to try to manipulate it and take it away from the voters of Mississippi. These are who these people are.
You're riling me up again.
I'm sorry, I know.
In an hour. You're riling me up again. How do they sleep at night? Honestly, how does Orrin Hatch sleep at night? You're not going to give me an answer? You're going to rile me up, and then you're not going to give me an answer on that? How do they sleep at night?
Well, Glenn, chamomile tea is a wonderful thing to drink right before bed.
No, it's too late now.
No,
it's
I'm trying to bring you back.
Okay, so, no. So here's how we deal with it, okay? Here's how we deal with it. I happen to be out on the ranch, and I am sitting now right on my front porch, and it is a beautiful day. And this is how we stress release here on the ranch. Okay, if you just saw it, you guys go ahead and talk amongst yourself.
Okay,
and I'm just going to stress relief here just for a second here.
Okay, Glenn is apparently walking somewhere on his porch, and hopefully this is safe for air.
I'm guessing
we don't know.
I'm guessing this involves a weapon of some sort. Perhaps okay. Firing a weapon of some sort.
I don't know. He's now
picking up a rifle.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yes, he's now he's now firing weapons on the air.
Yeah.
This is the sort of rhetoric I thought we got away from.
Mm-hmm.
This is why Thad Cochran has to be in power, because of people like Glenn Beck who have weapons and will fire them randomly at ranches anywhere in America.
And you know what happened? You know what just happened?
What
just happened? It jammed. It just jammed. That's what happened. So now you think. You'll get me riled up, and then my weapon jams. It's not helping me.
No, it's not.
It also shows how flawed the primary system is in so many states. There's no reason for any state to ever allow members of the opposite party to vote in somebody else's primary.
Never.
There's no reason for that. Why would you do that? Why would you leave it open to Democrats or to Republicans in a
Democrat
primary?
Because of what happened last night. They want it. They are more comfortable with the president's policies than they are with Chris McDaniel. That doesn't make any sense.
No question. It shows you how not conservative Thad Cochran and all these ancient senators who supported him and donated to the cause. It shows how unconservative they all are, from Orrin Hatch to John Cornyn to all these guys that we complain about on a pretty regular basis. They all need to go.
Did Glenn just shoot another?
Yeah, he did.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's be fair. I could not work with Lindsey Graham, because Lindsey Graham is two-faced. I can have a relationship with somebody who will say the same thing to my face as they will to my back when my back is turned. Then I can have a relationship with you. You can say, Glenn, I really don't like you. I really, and here's the reasons why, and I'm being honest about it. I can actually have respect for you on that. But I can't with somebody who will tell me one thing and do another. I can't have a relationship. So who do you have a relationship with in Washington, D.C.? The ones who are having these relationships are the ones who are cutting deals. And I know Washington is about cutting deals, but not cutting deals around principle. And that's what they're doing. They're cutting deals around principle. Is John in North Carolina there?
I'm here.
Hi, John. Hello. Welcome to the Glenbeck Program.
Hey, how you doing? I think I have thought a lot about this and have a solution to the GOP problem. Love to hear what you guys think. I think that in these upcoming general elections for 2014, that Tea Party or constitutional conservatives, individualists, whatever you want to call us, on election day should rally and sit out the elections and let the world know why and completely undermine the power of the GOP to get them in line for 2016.
I'd like to hear Stu's response to this, quite honestly.
Of course you did, because the audio wasn't working and I couldn't hear any of the call.
Except for the last three or four words.
Okay, so his idea was, he said, individualist, which I like. He said, you know, instead of constitutionalist, individualist. Individualist, if you're part of the Tea Party, you should sit out this next election and say, and let everybody know. No, you know what? Let the Republicans get what they deserve. I'm not going to vote against. I'm just not going to vote this time.
Yeah, I mean, it would teach the Republicans a lesson, whether they would respond to it. I mean, we taught them a lesson in Ohio, and we saw how they've responded to that. You know, I don't know that it would work, and then you would have...
taught them a lesson in Virginia as well.
Yeah, that's what I meant. I'm sorry, Virginia. We also have a situation where we would have several years of, in this potential situation, of unbridled power on the other side. Now, look... The issue with, of course, Democrats and why being a collectivist is so wonderful is because when you can get you get 1 year of ability to pass something and then it sticks around forever. So you pass something like an Obamacare or one of these big programs like Medicare. You just need to get it through once and it lasts forever. So if you let go of the opposition to those things, you're going to be paying a price for a really long time. And you're betting and hoping that it works out to the point where you're able to reverse it, I guess, later on, and everybody understands that you're right
so
and they're wrong.
So what do you do? Because, you know, we've tried all the rest. What do you do? What is your suggestion?
Well, I mean, here's what I would say. We have tried this direction the last, since, what, 2010, essentially. And what we've received from that is the biggest landslide in the history of the Republican Party the last 100 years. Many of the people who did that were not establishment people. They were good, solid congressmen and senators that we brought on. We've continued that in many cases with some victories and some losses. And to say that this theory of what we're doing is a disaster because... We lost by 4,000 votes in Mississippi and lost a couple of other races that we hoped we would win. There's been victories, too. Obviously, the Eric Cantor one is one of the highest profile ones. But, you know, we're talking about people like Ben Sass and some others. It hasn't been a great year for this. But, I mean, I think part of the theory here is to continue doing what we're doing and finding these guys. As you said in the lead up to this election, Glenn, you know, these guys were nowhere. There weren't even these possibilities before 2010 and even in 2012 to some degree. These guys didn't even exist. And the fact that a lot of these guys came out of nowhere, no one knew who they were. They were running for the first time in these public races. They had no name recognition and were outspent 10-1 and then lost by a few thousand votes isn't exactly the worst defeat in history. Sometimes these things don't move as quickly as we want them to. But I think, though, and Thad Cochran, I'm so angry at right now, I can't be rational about him. Mm-hmm. But some of these races, you know, do you want another, you know, rubber stamp vote for President Obama's policies in there? And I think when it comes down to it, you're going to have to make a choice and realize that even if you don't only like the guy on 60 or 70% of the issues, you have to do something and then try to knock him out next time. That's kind of where I am.
Here's where I am. And I agree with you on this one. You know, I am so angry about what happened in Mississippi you know, I don't know what I would do if I was in Mississippi. I might actually vote for the Democrat because I'd rather know exactly what I'm getting. I know what I'm getting with the Democrat. I don't know what I'm getting with Thad Cochran. I don't know who now he owes favors to. The New York Times is demanding them. The NAACP is demanding a return of the favor. So I don't know what backdoor deal. I'd rather have somebody who's clean. I'd rather have them get in there. Fine. That's fine. I am in my more rational moments as I get away from the anger of what the GOP did. I realize that the last part of a social movement, the last step before you win, is you want to give up because you think there's no way to win. That's the last step.
Mm-hmm.
And you know it to be true, even if you're an entrepreneur. You know the minute you're like, okay, well, we're just going to have to close the doors. I'm just going to have to give up because it's just not going to work. This is our last point. That's usually when it happens. And I just, in looking at the growth of this movement and looking at the standard cycle of political movements, we are in the last phase. If we don't give up, this is always the secret of this cycle. In fact, Stu, can you look it up? There's like those five steps of a political movement. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
Look that up real quick for me if you can find it. And it is, the last step is you win. Right before that is, don't give up. You're about to win. And where political movements always go awry is where we're at right now. Maybe we should just give up. Maybe we shouldn't just do anything. Screw them. You know what? We're not going to pay attention. That's actually probably exactly the wrong thing to do. Even though that's what I feel like doing, it's the wrong thing to do. While Stu looks that up, let me go to Allison in Mississippi. Hello, Allison. You're on the Glenn Beck program.
Hi. Thank you. I am from Mississippi, and I voted for McDaniel, and so did the rest of my family, and we were very angry at what happened with Thad Cochran. I won't be voting for him in the election. If I can write in McDaniel, I'll write in McDaniel. If not, I just won't vote.
And you're prepared to have the Republican or the Democrat win that seat?
I am. I'm so tired of the establishment. I have a 7-year-old, and I see where this country is going, and it scares me to death. I want him to have a better future, and Thad Cochran needs to be out. And if that means that a Democrat gets in, then that so be it.
The really tough part of that
in Mississippi. Yeah, go ahead.
The tough part of that is that the Republicans are this close from taking control of the Senate, and then having the Senate and the House, and so you lose Mississippi. You know, that's one of those key races that Republicans are really counting on. So, you know, it may swing the Senate.
Let me ask you this. Do you actually believe, though, Pat, that they'll do something? I mean, look at what John Boehner is doing. He's suing the president. Yeah. I mean, come on, man. There are other things that you can do that are constitutional besides suing the president. Mm-hmm. And the tripwires are all there. Jonathan Turley has been saying over and over and over again, This is a government out of control. They've had the opportunity to stop universal health care. They're not stopping it. So true. When they have both, I mean, last time they had the presidency and both houses, we got prescription drugs.
Yeah,
we got another big war. I mean,
and
no, thank you.
And
no,
we got a temporary tax cuts.
Yeah.
Temporary. They couldn't even make that permanent.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
But
yeah.
I mean, temporary tax cuts. And here's another thing. Temporary tax cuts. And they also gave us the light bulbs. It was George Bush that actually did this to the light bulbs.
Definitely
true. We lost all those jobs. We were making incandescent light bulbs.
I mean, this is a pretty good case because you add on top of that, they didn't get the border situation taken care of. In fact, it got much worse.
Nope.
Under the Republican-controlled government. And so, what good was it?
Well, here's
what good was it?
Let me give you this idea. This is from a couple of weeks ago when Lindsey Graham won. This is from Real Clear Politics. And he's Sean Trent is explaining, you know, what conservatives feel. And tell me this is not a good case. Republicans gave control to a Republican, the voters gave control to the actual Republicans back in the 2000s. And what do Republicans have to show for it? Temporary tax cuts, No Child Left Behind, Medicare prescription drug benefit, a new cabinet department, increased federal spending, TARP, and repeated attempts at immigration reform. Basically, despite a historic opportunity to shrink government, almost everything that the GOP establishment achieved during that time moved the needle leftward on domestic policy. Probably the only unambiguous win for conservatives were the Roberts and Alito appointments in the Supreme Court.
And the Roberts you can't even claim.
That's what he says. The former is viewed with suspicion today, at least, and the latter only came about after the base revolted against Harriet Myers. I mean, if that's the, that's a really good boil down of
Allison,
that era.
You're probably, I mean, I think you're right, Allison. I think you're right, actually.